tonight on Access TV. Live. Live. With Gotham Comedy. Live. Get ready to laugh. With Eric Lyden. Helen Hong. Pete Davidson. Paul Mecurio. And your host, Loni Love. From the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Live. All happening right now. Ladies and gentlemen, your host, Loni Love.
To Gotham Comedy Live. I'll be your host, Loni Love. Thank y'all for coming out. I'm tell y'all something about y'all in New York, because y'all from LA, right? Y'all walk real fucking fast out here. The old people knocking me over. I'm about to knock out an old person, all right? So let me tell y'all, this is a 100% live comedy show. We thank y'all for watching at home, so we don't know what's gonna happen. I hope I don't get too drunk, but if you do, it just happened, you know. I want to give a shout out also to my girl, Lisa Lampanelli. She's in the house. Lisa, stand up. I know you somewhere. Lisa Lampanelli. Yeah. Lisa, there she is. Lisa Lampanelli, ladies. You done went over to the other side, Lisa. She a skinny bitch now. You see it? She a skinny bitch. She can cross her legs now. I haven't crossed my legs since 1992, Lisa. I crossed my legs. I cut off all my circulation to kill myself. How she died? She crossed her legs, you know. Y'all, I got this new show with Shaquille O'Neal called Upload with Shaq. I like Shaquille. He's a great friend of comedy. He is, you know. And you feel a little uncomfortable when you stand in front of Shaq because he's over 7 feet tall. So when you stand in front of him, all you see is his dick. That's all you see. Get your dick out my face, Shaq, okay? I'm gonna tell you something else, Shaq. You can't fit in that fucking Buick. Stop trying to tell America you can fit in that car. You cannot fit. He can't fit in that Buick, can he? You don't know Buick. I know you can't fit in that car. I know that much. You know, they tried to put me and Shaq in the Buick. It took them 2 hours to get our big asses out. We, like, get some butter. We need to get out of here, you know? Hey. I was watching the other day, 2 weeks ago, Morgan Freeman, the actor, was doing a little interview for his show, for his movie called Now You See Me. Morgan Freeman, and it was Michael Caine, the actor. Morgan Freeman fell asleep right in the middle of the fuck, seriously, stone cold, like that. I'm like, first of all, give Morgan an energy drink. You know your old ass need an energy drink. Has Morgan Freeman ever been young? Have we ever seen a young picture? I tried Googling, I ain't seen no young pictures of Morgan. He been old ever since we know him, you know? And I'm gonna tell y'all, you can do whatever you wanna do, New York. I have a radio show called Cafe Mocha Radio. It's a syndicated radio show. 3 months ago, I got a call from the White House. The White House said, Michelle Obama wants you to interview her. And I was like, honored. And then I got scared because I was like, I may not pass a security clearance, you know? Because I done did some stuff in 96, y'all, I ain't proud of, right? You know? So the Secret Service guy, and I'm gonna tell you something, they protect her more than they protect President Obama. Because they was going through the list and they said, well, what happened 6 months ago? Let me tell y'all what happened 6 months ago, okay? I'm from Detroit, it was Christmas. All 35 of us went home to see Grandma for Christmas. She started bringing up old ass stories. That was the first problem, all right? You know how Grandma started talking? Then the second thing is we started drinking. So we was drunk and we got mad about them old stories. So all 35 of us started fighting each other, right? We started fighting so bad, they called the Detroit police. We started fighting the Detroit police. So they put all 35 of our asses in jail. I'm the only person with the money, so I had to bail everybody out. I didn't mind that, but it took me 3 days to bail everybody out because I didn't know everybody's real fucking name. Because we all got nicknames, right? So I'm at the jail with a list of names I have never seen before. I'm like, Who is Kenneth Billingsworth? Who the Oh, that's my cousin Skillet. Let me go get Skillet out of jail. Skillet! I didn't even know my grandmama name because I just know her as grandmama. So I'm like, let me look for the oldest name on the list. Clarabelle, that's gotta be her. They don't make Clarabelles no more. That sound pre-civil rights right there. That's got to be her. She know Morgan Freeman, you know? It's just... I get her out of jail, she got attitude. What took you so long? I ain't know your fucking name, Clarabelle, you know? So we did everything. We passed all the security clearance, and they tell me where to go to talk to the first lady. And they serious, right? They picked the place, everything. I put on my headphones because it's a radio show, and a general come in. This is General Smith. Thank you for doing this interview. I'm going to turn on a little music, and it's some patriotic music. Da, 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 da. And I'm like, oh, shit, this is serious. And then he comes back. You got 20 minutes. You have 15 minutes. And then finally, her press secretary comes in and says, thank you so much for doing this interview with the first lady. You have 5 minutes with her. The next voice you hear, be the first lady of the United States. And Michelle comes in. Hey, Loni. And my dumb ass don't know what to do, right? I don't know what to salute or to say, your honor, whatever. So I just do what comes natural. I say, ah, right? And we had a great conversation. She actually talked to me for 15 minutes, and we had a great conversation until she said, Loni, we need to talk about that Let's Move program. I said, you talking about exercising, First Lady? This interview is over, okay? And I'm gonna tell y'all something. I feel like I know Michelle Obama because about 3 weeks ago, she was at a fundraiser and somebody tried to heckle her. Do y'all hear this? They tried to heckle her. And Michelle is very, very smart and intelligent woman. And she was, you know, just talking. She was talking about the kids. And this woman just, right? And so Michelle stopped and she said, this I don't do well. Now let me translate that to all my vanilla friends. You feel me, sister, okay? When Michelle said, this I don't do well, what she really wanted to say is, bitch, I'm not Barack, all right? So, and I tell y'all that story because if it's something you want to do in your life and you want to do it, you better focus and do it and change. Do not let anything keep you down. And I say that because I used to be an engineer. Now, I was the worst engineer in the United States of America. Anybody driving a 92 Cutlass, take that bitch back. We built that motherfucker. It don't work. I'm sorry. I fucked up. I was drunk and shit. It was 3 o'clock in the morning. I'm just getting from the club at 2:30. I'm like, shit, we gotta go to work already? Damn. You know, I put, engine's supposed to have 52 screws. I put 2 screws in it. Sit on down. It'll be all right, you know. I was on ChristianMingle.com the other day, y'all. I was on ChristianMingle.com trying to find God's match for me. And I found me a man on ChristianMingle.com. Do y'all know he texted me a picture of his dick on ChristianMingle.com? And under it, he put the caption, this is where I keep my holy water. I'm like, what the fuck? On ChristianMingle.com. I could have did it for free on Craigslist. Some bullshit. Then I realized something. See, that's what a lot of you young men do. You text and see, that's why some of y'all getting quiet. I'm looking at your faces. You texting pictures. Texting pictures of your penis to women. It does not turn on a woman when you text a picture of your penis. You want to turn on a woman, text a picture of your bank account. Do that. That's what you like. Right on. Right on. Right on. You want to turn me on? Text a picture of your bank account wrapped in bacon. Do that. We about to start this show. Y'all ready to start the show? We'll be right back with more Gotham Live on Access TV.
Stay tuned for more Laughs on Access TV. Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Eric Lyden is taking the stage when we return. Welcome back to the Access TV presentation of Gotham Comedy Live. More laughs happening right now.
Welcome back. The next young man you've seen on Comedy Comics Unleashed. Can you please give it up to the very funny Eric Lyden? Come on, Eric.
Thank you very much. Thank you, that's nice of you. Anyone else think the people that work airport security should look better? I do, especially when you consider all the health and beauty products they keep taking away from us. Hey, before you throw my aftershave in the garbage, why don't you slap some on yourself, lady? There's a guy who works at JFK. I see him every time I fly. The guy never looks good. He never smells good. In fact, I put soap and moisturizer in my carry-on every time I fly. I'm hoping he'll take the hint, but not yet. You keep bringing it, I keep taking it. I'm like, I know. I got singled out for the random search a few months ago, and most people don't like being searched, you know? But I'm married, so I like the fact someone's gonna touch me. Yeah. I'll even fake a Middle Eastern accent if I think it'll get me the cavity search. Eric Lyden, no, that is my infidel name. Given to me by my infidel parents. You're born in Cleveland. No, Jihad City, actually. Now, is someone gonna take me in the back and check my prostate for explosives? Now, if you've ever been singled out for the search, you know it's a very insulting process, but it's nice because it puts you in touch with the inner profiler in you. Yeah, we all like to think we're PC, but trust me, when you start getting patted down in front of 200 people, it takes about 3 seconds to go from Gandhi to Grand Wizard. You're like, me? You want to check me? How about the guy in the magic carpet that just floated by? You don't want to see what Alibaba has under the... Guy looks like Zoltar from Big, and you're worried about me. Look at his shoes. Those are fuses for laces. He's got a ShamWow on his head. Oh, he's the pilot. Oh. I might want to check him anyway. I've been to a lot of weird places. Probably the strangest place was a swingers cruise last year. And I don't mean people who enjoy the monkey bars. Talking about swingers. You go to any kind of swingers events, like going to Vietnam. Because when you come back, you're not the same. Especially when it comes to sex with your wife. What's wrong, honey? You don't know because you weren't there, man. You didn't see what I saw, man. Folks, I saw anything and everything when it comes to sex. They even had a dungeon room for people who enjoy being whipped. Not only could you get whipped, you could watch people being whipped. Of course, I pop my head in, it's two men. Don't misunderstand that. I'm thrilled we're coming around on gay rights, marriage equality, but this wasn't sexual. It was a black guy whipping a white guy, and he kept saying, "How do you like it?" You're white, don't say stuff like that. You know, speaking of the always uplifting subject of slavery, not only do I not understand how something that evil ever took place, but as a white guy, I can't figure out why it wasn't the other way around. I don't know about anybody else, but I see black folks, the last thing I'm gonna do is tell them what to do. Are you kidding me? If I owned a plantation, it would have gone out of business right after the grand opening, I promise you. Hey, that cotton isn't gonna pick itself. What? All right, take it easy, I got it. I got it, it's all good. I got it. No. It's not a whip, it's a jump rope. Most exciting place I've ever been was Hong Kong. I loved everything except the flight. It was a 15-hour flight. I was in a middle seat, and I was stuck. Oh, yeah, it gets worse. I was stuck next to a woman with a very unhappy baby. My wife and kid. That was a year ago. I still feel bad about switching my seat. Yeah. Who wants to sit next to that for 15 hours? You're gonna wake up the baby. I went to Hong Kong to visit my wife's family. I married a beautiful Chinese woman. And I'll be honest with you, I fell in love with Hong Kong, but unless you're Chinese, that's a confusing place. I must have hugged the wrong woman 10 times. You know, once or twice, it's cute. If you get up in double digits, you're just a white pervert with yellow fever. We've been together 10 years, been in New York the whole time, and because we're New Yorkers, that means we have to go to Central Park every Sunday. My wife is one of those women who likes to lay out a, like to, you know, lay out a blanket, you know, sell DVDs. By the way, just in case anybody's wondering, I know those jokes are racist, but I'm white, all right? That's what we do. Don't act surprised. I'd love to see the black-white racism come to an end, but it just seems like there's always going to be those inbred white people who say things like white power but never have white teeth. It's ironic, isn't it? White hair! Oh, my God. You know what else has power? Colgate. There's two things I hate about racism, aside from the obvious, but first is, it always seems to come out of nowhere, you know? And it never puts you in a good mood, does it? About a year ago, my wife and I were having trouble sleeping, so she bought one of those white noise machines. Awful. Yeah, like, one of you black people, go back to Africa. All night long. It's supposed to help you sleep, but there's nothing relaxing about that. Tell you who I feel bad for is my daughter. Of course, she's biracial, so you know it's not going to be easy. I'm going to have to sit her down and say, listen, hybrid. We haven't decided what religion my daughter should be, because my wife is Catholic, but I was raised Crystal Methodist. I don't know. Well, some people find Jesus. Well, we hang out with him. Speaking of my wife, you know, I've never been happier in my entire life. And it's because my wife is the reason for that. But even with that said, there's still a small part of me that wouldn't be surprised if we don't make it. I don't trust marriage for one second. I really don't. I wish I did. But to me, marriages are like fat people. Yeah, they should work out. But I did get lucky. My wife's an amazing woman, very impressive, very, very funny, a beautiful woman, even has a master's degree in psychology. But, of course, it should be in archaeology. Like most women, she's great at digging up crap from the past that nobody cares about. You're going to argue with a woman's study, because there will be a pop quiz in history.
Oh, yeah, remember what you said to me 4 years ago on New Year's Eve?
Happy New Year. By the way, during the election, my wife said something a few years ago. She goes, you know, we're going to elect a woman president someday. When we do, we won't go to war. I said, honey, we'll still go to war. It's just the other country will have no idea what it did wrong. You guys have been a lot of fun. I hope you enjoyed it.
From the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, Helen Hong is taking the stage when we return.
The next comic, you can see her in the upcoming Coen Brothers movie, and she's my girl, so give it up to the very funny Helen Hong. Come on, Helen.
Thank you. What's up, bitches? What's up? Oh, thank you guys so much for coming out. I hope you guys laugh a lot because I could be making so much more money giving massages right now. Right, gentlemen, huh? It's nice to see you sitting up. It's different. I almost didn't recognize this guy. Wow, he's good. He's good. So, guys, my name is Helen, which is a great name to have if you never want to feel sexy ever. It's up there with Bertha and Agnes, you know? And for some reason, all young Asian women, we all have old white lady names. Have you noticed? We're all like Helen or Esther or Pearl. It's like our immigrant parents got their hands on a baby name book from the 1920s and they were just passing it around. Like my dad was like, oh. Oh! Hidden! Oh, abandoned eyes, hidden! Hidden Hong! I like it. So catchy. Here's the thing about the name Helen. There have only been two really famous Helens in all of history, right? One of them was the most beautiful woman in the world, Helen of Troy, and the other famous Helen was blind, deaf, and dumb. Guess which Helen I'm named after? Not the hot one. So one day I asked my dad, I'm like, Dad, why would you name me after someone who's so severely handicapped? And he goes, oh, Helen, I want you to overcome any adversity. I wanted to name you Stephen Hawking, but mommy said no. She said no. That's good. I get hit on a lot by 22-year-olds, which is very flattering, but I'm way older than I look. I'm 77 years old. I look amazing, right? We don't age. My people don't age. Black people and Asian people don't age. Like, this lady is probably 95. She looks amazing. You look incredible. Black people have a really cool saying, black don't crack, right? Black don't crack, it means black people don't age. Asians don't have a saying, so I wrote one, rice stays nice. Huh? Thank you. You guys can use it. You can use it. I wrote it. It's yours. Rice stays nice. I have always looked really young for my age. Like when I was in college, I looked like a chubby 12-year-old. But I wanted to be one of those slutty college girls that runs around campus going, titties! But no one wants to see that from a chubby 12-year-old going, titties! Nobody. Nobody. So now I feel like I finally look like I'm old enough to be a girls gone wild, but now I'm too old to hang out where college girls hang out. You know, like you'll always see girls gone wild, Cancun! But you'll never see girls gone wild, the vitamin shop! No, nothing? I finally have a boyfriend now. Yeah, he's white. You're welcome. He is white. This is how white he is. He's from Wisconsin. That's like aggressively white. You know what I'm saying? Like they drink milk over there, like with dinner. You know what I mean? That's really, really white. And he has never dated a non-white woman before me ever in his whole life. All of his past girlfriends were blonde with big boobs. And so now he says really sweet things to me like, honey, your people used to freak the shit out of me. But now I love getting my nails done. So romantic. He is so romantic, this guy. I usually do end up dating white guys, not because I am racist, but because my butt is like Goldilocks. Check it out. It is not enough butt for black and Latino men. Right, brothers out there, right? They're like, where is it? Oh my God, it curves in. I know, not enough butt for black and Latino men, but way, way too much butt for Asian guys. Right, buddy? He's like, what is that? It's huge. I know. This thing makes me the Korean Kim Kardashian. I am like the Beyonce of Asia with this thing. It's a bubble butt. And I'm stacked! these are ginormous Asian titties. I go to Asia and businessmen try to motorboat me on the street. They're like, awesome. I'm like, it's just a B cup, calm down. It's just a B cup. My, this white boyfriend that I have is very serious with him. He is the only boyfriend in my life to ever meet my parents, which is very serious. And this is how it went down. He was staying at my place. My parents flew in from out of town. And I don't know if you guys know this about immigrants, but they don't rent hotel rooms to save their lives. Like, no matter what, pay for sleeping? No way, why? They don't do it. So now all four of us are supposed to sleep together in my tiny one-bedroom apartment. And my mom's like, Helen, where did you everybody gonna sleep? And I'm like, well, Mom, you and Dad can sleep in the bedroom, and David and I can sleep in the living room. And she goes, oh, my God. Oh God. You're sleeping together? Oh, my God. But you're not married. You're not a slut. And I was like, well, you're not going to rent a hotel room, so what's your idea? And she goes, oh, okay, Helen, I have a better idea. You and the mommy, we sleeping together in a bedroom, and David and Danny sleep together on a futon. I'm like, bitch, are you crazy? You want this poor white Wisconsin boy who drinks milk to climb into bed with a 70-year-old Korean man that he's never met before? How is that gonna work? Are they gonna sleep head to foot? Are they gonna build an awkward wall with pillows? My dad's gonna climb into bed in his old man jammies, like, okay, baby, the nice to meet you, good night. No homo! No homo, no funny stuff. I need to take a moment to vent. I don't really even have a joke for this, but I just need to vent for a second. If one more non-Asian person bows at me for no fucking reason, I'm gonna cut a bitch. What is that about? Like, what do they think is gonna happen? I'm gonna be like, oh, thank you so much. Shake my hand. I don't get it. I don't get it. But you bowing, I feel so much better. Thank you. Gong. Like, what? Stop. Just stop it. It's ridiculous. I am originally from here in New York, but I moved to Los Angeles last year to become famous. And I'm learning how racist Hollywood is. Oh my God, Hollywood is so racist. The other day, I auditioned to play the role of Golden Dragon Restaurant Lady. That is the actual name of the character. Golden Dragon Restaurant Lady, she's got one line. And the line is, beef and broccoli combo number two with egg roll. Which is exactly how I said it, when they're like, that's really great, Helen. Now, could you try that again as if English was not your first language? Which is such a diplomatic way of saying, chink it up, girl, come on, go full on, chink it down with it. Like, she might as well have been like, could you try that again as if you were the concubine of an abusive rice farmer? Could you try that again as if you just got off of a 12-hour shift at Elegant Nails? Could you try that again as if ding 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 is your favorite song? I was like, all right, bitch, I'll let you have it. I went over the top. I transformed into a psychotic Korean grandmother. I was like, beef and broccoli combo number two! You eat the lice! You eat the noodle, you know egg roll, I shove up your asshole! Guess what, I got it! You guys have been great, thank you so much, thank you!
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Pete Davidson is taking the stage when he returns. Right. Welcome back to the Access TV presentation of Gotham Comedy Live. More laughs happening right now.
We are live in New York City, and the next young man, you know him from MTV's Guy Code. He's very, very funny. Please welcome Pete Davidson. Come on, Pete.
Yay. How is everybody? You guys good? You good? Everybody happy? I'm 19, and I just dropped out of college. Anybody else? No? Nobody? You dropped out? I dropped out because I was dorming. And I didn't like dorming. That's it. I hated it, man. I didn't speak to any of my roommates. I think it's because the first morning we all woke up with a boner and we were like, this isn't for any of us. Now we know who's bigger, so there's always that like, It was horrible, man. They thought, my roommates were stupid. They thought it was awesome. They're like, yeah, man, we live on our own. I'm like, yeah, man, we eat Hot Pockets every night. Like, I miss my mom. Like, I want to go home. I want chicken cutlets. This is bullshit. One time we ran out of toilet paper and we just didn't get any. But everybody took a shit every day, and nobody knew what they used. It was like this don't ask, don't tell policy that we had. One time, a roommate came out of the bathroom with one sock. I was like, fuck, we need toilet paper. I hate college, man. Another reason why I dropped out, I was taking this class, and there was a retarded kid in it. Hear me out, okay? I know that sounds awful, but like, I have a retarded cousin. I'm nothing against retarded kids, but like, the problem I have is I'm in that class. So one thing came to my mind when I saw the retarded kid. I was like, am I fucking retarded? Like, is this how they're gonna tell me? Like, really? Because the problem with that is I wouldn't be surprised if I found it. You know, I'm awkward, people are nice to me. Like, I wouldn't be shocked if I found out. Then it made me angry. I was furious. You have any idea how hard I worked to get into college? I was so excited. I got a new backpack. Got a nice little haircut. And I walk in there, this retarded kid's just like, you made it. I'm like, yeah, I made it. How did you make it? Like, what test did you take? I had to sit behind a retarded kid. Which means I can never be absent. Because you always know who sits behind the retarded kid. It's the next normal person in attendance. The retarded kid always fucked up the attendance rhythms. Not my fault. His name was Timmy. It was Scott, Timmy, and then Pete. So he'd be like, Scott? He'd be like, here. And he'd be like, Timmy? He's like, here. And then they're like, Pete? I'm like, yeah, I'm right behind Timmy. Like, you can't. Guess who's not cheating in this class? Okay. It was fucked up because the retarded kid actually got better grades than I did. Not because he's smart, you just can't fail a retarded kid. You can't do that. No teacher will ever do that. One day they will, and there'll be a movie, but until then. Got better grades than I did, so I actually used to cheat off him. I cheated off the retarded kid. Every test, I draw a dragon. He got an A with his dragon. I failed. But mine had scales. Yeah, here's how I knew this class was bullshit. We had movie day. And I'll never forget, this is a true story. The teacher picked Forrest Gump, which is hilarious. It was really good. And I'll never forget, this is a true story. Before he starts the movie, he goes, "All right, class, who here saw Forrest Gump?" And I swear to God, the retarded kid, he comes out of nowhere and he just goes, "That's my favorite movie." And I laughed so fucking hard. I laughed so hard, and then I looked around, nobody else was laughing. And that made me realize I haven't grown up yet. Like, even the retarded kid was like, "Are you fucking serious right now?" That's a nice dragon. I was a loser in high school. A big loser. I had a rolling school bag. Senior year. Do you have any idea how hard it is to get pussy with a rolling school bag? What do you say to girls? Just roll up on a girl like, "Hey, girl. Textbooks are heavy." Okay. People used to make fun of me. They'd be like, "You're a homo. You got a rolling school bag." And I couldn't even make fun of them because you have to pay attention to where the fuck you're going. Yeah, well, no. I can't look up. I can hit a rock. And it's all... Any NBA fans in here? NBA? Yeah. Yeah, gay guy. We got a gay guy now. Here's what it was. I was really excited when I first heard about the gay guy, because I'm a big NBA fan, so anything that changes the sport in a little way, I get excited. You know, I was like, "Oh, it's cool. We're going to have a gay NBA superstar. I can't wait for them to announce this." And then they announced it. I was like, "Yo, who the fuck is this guy?" Like, who? I had to Google him. He averages 2 points a game. Who gives a shit? He's a gay bench warmer. It doesn't really... 2 points a game, that means in the video game, he doesn't even have a face. Everybody's like, "It's shocking. I can't believe he's gay." I'm like, "He played 12 seasons and he had zero injuries." It's like the gayest shit I've ever heard in my life. Always ready to play. I would want a gay guy on my team. I would want one. You know why? 95% of NBA players are homophobic. So I would just put him on the best player every single game. Yeah. You'll see Kobe just hanging out at half court, just waiting. Like, "Kobe, cut to the basket." "Nope, next game. I don't really give a fuck." If I was the gay dude, I'd be super gay too. I'd be like, "Hey, Kobe. Defense. I have a lot of gay friends. I have a lot of gay friends, and the stuff they say makes my butthole pucker. Like, I have to sit down. But I put up with it because they cook. I'll give you an example. My gay friend was like, "Craig won't poke me back on Facebook. I just want to suck his dick. What do I do?" I'm like, "Dude, shut the fuck up. That's what you do." And then he's like, "I made cookies." I'm like, "Tell me more about Craig." Guys, that's my time. I'm Pete Davidson. Thank you. Enjoy the rest of your show.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV. Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, Paul Mecurio is taking the stage when we return.
snagged an interview with Sir Paul McCartney. It will be on his podcast this Tuesday on iTunes, so check it out. This guy is the real deal. He's my funny friend. Give it up for Paul Mecurio. Come on, Paul.
Thank you. Thank you. Black women love me. Am I right, Asian guy? Black women love me. Way to go. How the hell is this happening? Seriously. You don't know? Did you drug them? What is going on? How are you? Ooh, how's it going? Oh, you went like, oh my God. You would never go back, I swear to God. I won't either. Oh my God. I think you would hurt me. I would like it. I almost got killed last week. I almost got hit by a smart car. You can't die that way. There's no dignity dying that way. This is when I realized how small a smart car is. It cut me off like inches from my face, and my instinct reflexively was to just push it out of the way. It's tired living in this city. I am so tired. You ever been so tired you look at a homeless guy asleep on the street and go, boy, I wish I could sleep like that. I don't need a box spring. I need a box. I'm married. Sorry. It doesn't have to change. What's that? She doesn't have to know? This show is over, everybody. You are such a lovely, slutty woman. I love you. Oh, my God. Look at that. That'll never happen for you. But anyway... You should school him. I'm married 12 years. I dated my wife 13 years before we got married. We met in high school. Relax, ladies. We met in high school, and we dated a while, and then she proposed, finally. I can't tell you her exact words because I get really emotional, but they ended with, or get off the pot! One argument, 3 times a month. If you're in a relationship, married, single, whatever, you've had this fight. I can't do little things, and it drives her crazy, but then her reaction to me drives me nuts. You've had this argument. I'm in the refrigerator, and she's in the living room, and I'm like, Cal, where are the pickles? She's like, you know where they are. No, I don't. Yes, you do. No, I don't. They're in the refrigerator. I know that. They're pickles. Where? You know where they are. No, I don't. This is funny to her. Hit her. Hit her right now. You know what you do. You know where they're on the shelf. I know. Pickles go on the shelf. Where? Then this is the line. This is the line, guys, where she says it, and you think to yourself, I could knock her out and drive her to the river, and nobody will know. This is the line. You ready? Are you looking? Yeah, then this next line, you need like a team of psychiatrists to decipher. He does this. I could tell he does this, right? And you need like a team of psychiatrists to decipher this next line. Yeah, I'm looking. Are you looking or just looking? I'm looking. You never look for things. You're like a child. You have to look. I'm not going to look for it. And then. You get this really condescending tone in your voice, like you're the control tower talking down the plane and we're all mentally challenged. It's like, all right, do you see the bread? Yes, I see the bread. Okay, well, if you look, you'll notice the pickles are right behind the bread. I don't see them. Then here comes the next line, and the judge hears this, and he goes, justifiable homicide. Did you move the bread? Yeah, did you move the bread or just move the bread? I moved the bread. Would you move it like 2 inches? You're like a child. You have to, all right, I moved the bread. And what do you see? Nothing. Exactly, Paul, because you forgot to buy pickles on the way home last night. Going to get a hotel. I'm not equipped to be a parent either. I got a kid, and let me show you what my kid gave me for good luck for the show before I left the apartment. This was huge. I know, it was like, it's his favorite toy right now. He gave me his favorite dinosaur. Isn't that cute? Yeah, he's 15, but no, he's 11, and you know, at this age, it's like it's all about the kid all the time, 24/7, you know? And sometimes you resent it because you want to do stuff for yourself. You know what I'm saying, dude? Like this past weekend, he had a baseball tournament. My wife's like, you go, father-son bonding weekend. And I did it, 3 days with him, and at the end of the weekend it hit me, I don't really care for the kid. Because it's all about the kid, you don't have any time to yourself, like Saturday night, it's my night too, I want to go to a club, and he starts complaining. Daddy, the lady on the pole scares me. This Jack Daniels is burning my throat. You call that weed? I don't need to take that shit. It's the most important thing you can do is have a kid and no one checks with you from the government to see if you're qualified. I'm an idiot and they let me have a kid. The first indication you don't know what you're doing as a parent, my son was like 10 months old and he had his first night terror. He's holding on to his crib for dear life. 3 o'clock in the morning, bawling his eyes out. And me, Joe Brainiac, all I could think to do was try to reason with him. What? What is it, Alex? What's wrong? Tell Daddy. What is it? Like he's going to snap out of it and go, you want to know what's wrong, Paul? Come over here. I was nice and warm in the womb. You yanked me out of there. You snipped off my penis. You wrapped me in a plastic bag. I shit myself 8 times a day. You hung this mobile above my head. You think it's cute? It is freaking the shit out of me right now. When I'm hungry, I can't even go to the fridge and get a pudding pop. What the fuck do you think is wrong with me? Oh, and one other thing. You got me sitting in Santa's lap. Do you want me talking to strangers or don't you? So now he's at that age, I gotta have the talk with him. You know the talk? The don't tweet pictures of your junk to women. Lonnie talked about this. Only men do this. This is such a male DNA thing. Only men. Men are animals. Women are too sophisticated. Think about this. This is the most sophisticated, important invention since the car. And only men. Only men would think to take this and... Good for us, guys. Good for us. Good for us. Good for you guys. Yeah. Yeah. And by the way, ladies, can we get perspective on this for just a second? Now, I understand on some level you're not supposed to do that in polite circles, but is it the worst thing in the world to get a 2x2 grainy picture of a penis on a phone? I mean, you've all seen a penis. I know you have. We've done things to a penis. A penis has done things to you. Are you completely overwhelmed when you get a 2x2 grainy picture of a penis? Are you like, oh my God, what is this? I don't know, what do I, oh! Like, whoa, I don't want. Look, if I sent you a picture of my penis right now, you know what it would look like? It would look like a little baby bald eagle asleep in a nest. You'd want to pet it, you'd want to feed it, and then release it into the wild. Meanwhile, if you sent me a picture of your vagina, you know what I would do? I would fuck my phone. I would fuck it so hard and never call it again. Oh, my God. My lips are huge, aren't they? See the way he laughs so hard? You've been staring at him since I got up here. When I was 8, my lips were the same size as they are now. I could whisper in my own ear. My father would take me fishing, stick my face in the water, and say, okay, call your friends. Huge lips, no ass. How does God do that? That's a passive-aggressive God. I believe in God, but I think he's passive-aggressive. You don't think I'm right? A lot of design flaws in the animal kingdom. Look at the animals out there. God messed with some of those animals, like the platypus. It was Friday at 5, God wanted to get a beer. He's like, what do we got left for spare parts in the warehouse? What's that, a duck's bill? Put it on a beaver's ass and get it out of here. Look what he did to the kangaroo. Cute face, powerful legs, massive tail, an animal with a pocket. A pocket. What does God do? Makes his arms too short to reach it. Good night, everybody. I'm Paul Mecurio. Thank you very much.
Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV, live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City. Welcome back to the Access TV presentation of Gotham Comedy Live. More laughs happening right now.
Well, the show is finally over. I get to drink. So, yeah, we're going to take it to the head. Come on, y'all. Let's take it to the head. have a new book out. It's called Love 'Em or Leave 'Em, But Don't Get Stuck with the Tab. It's comedy advice for you women, because some of y'all need it. So make sure you pick it up today on Amazon.com, all those other places. And you guys have been a great, great crowd. I mean, you really, really have. Really, really have. I want to thank Access TV for, you know, putting this on, because live stand-up comedy really is suffering. And this just helps to bring, I want to thank the people at Gotham Comedy Live. Come down to this club, y'all. This is a great club. Can't you see it? Chris and all the gang, Sean, everybody. Thank you guys for having us tonight. It's a great club. You have to check out live stand-up comedy. It's the greatest thing. And remember, don't let anything bring you down. People try to say I'm fat. I'm not fat. I'm full. Okay? Remember that. Let's bring up